Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Welcome to Administrative Static. This is John Vecchione, and I'm here, as always, with Mark Chenoweth. And we have an interesting, it's not a court proceeding at all. The Presidential Commission on the Supreme Court released its, what I don't understand, it's called a draft final report, which strikes me as a little oxymoronic. But it's 288 pages long, and your humble correspondent must admit that in the time it took us to get to air, I could not read it all, but I have skimmed it and I have looked at some of the pieces of it. And I think the verdict is that the worst fears of those who were concerned about radical change to the Supreme Court and the hopes for those who wanted such change have been severely disappointed. And because this is a very useful, intelligent and fair-minded report, it doesn't really recommend anything strongly. It's not like the 34 people that the president appointed have all agreed on anything. They each what they do is they go back and forth and they say, here's the problem, here are the proposed solutions, here are the likely consequences of those proposed solutions or the things that you might want to worry about. And they go through an enormous amount of these. And there's no way in the time here that I can do that. But I do think that some of it's very interesting, that the tone of the document as to what we call, what I'll call pure court packing, which is you increase the number of seats when one party has control of all the branches of government, and you just put whoever is for that political party's program on that date all into the Supreme Court so that everything's rubber stamped by the Supreme Court afterwards that party's doing at that time. The whole tone of the document is that would ruin the Supreme Court's usefulness to the constitutional system. I obviously agree with that. But I feel that given how this commission came about and what the political forces were driving it, I'm a little surprised that they came out that way without even like a minority report or something. But they're fair-minded. They say why you might want this and they go through it and all this. I still think it's true from the last time we spoke about this that the key reform of the Supreme Court that has legs, that I think we're going to see again and again coming up in the next 20 years, is a fixed term for Supreme Court justices. There's the idea that every president who has two terms would get two appointments, I think it is. So every 18 years, the time would be up for certain justices, and so you'd have a more regular program, which the idea is that it would turn down the temperature of the confirmation process, which you could pretty much tell. I think even in when Dobbs, the abortion case, was argued the week before last, there is hanging in the air that has caused all of these confirmation battles.
Yeah.
Mark?
More than any other single case. Not exclusively, but more than any other single case.
Yeah, and so there is throughout this report a searching, I'd say, for things to lower the temperature. But my friend Quinn Hylier, in his, and I thank him for pointing this out to me, he has pointed out Appendix C, which I had not gotten to till I read his article, and then I looked through it. Appendix C is interesting. There is a it's by a a fellow named Peck who has his solutions and his proposals in this appendix have nothing to do with the judiciary. It's how the Senate should do its confirmation hearings. And he looks at the various things that the parties have accused each other of. And he says, well, if you didn't know who's going to win the Senate and the presidency next time, would you agree to these things? And then he lays out a number of proposals that would address each side's kind of attacks on another. One of them is the Senate would make a rule that that it would agree, regardless of what the Judiciary Committee voted on, that the Senate itself would vote up or down on a nominee unless withdrawn in a certain amount of time. And this obviously addresses the Merrick Garland situation. But then he also says, the other thing is we cannot have anonymous allegations against justices bruited about in open TV and unsubstantiated materials coming out at the last minute. And he goes on through how there should be secrecy in these things and how you can't bring them out in the open because it's unfair to the nominee and it doesn't help the process, which obviously in the Kavanaugh confirmation, this was a key matter. He talks about the role of the FBI. What should the FBI look at? How quickly should the FBI be involved and what should they be involved in? And then he also says that the ABA should not have premier a position in what it thinks about any of the nominees, that that is unfair and makes the process look unfair to tons of Americans, all of which I thought were fair-minded. Whether I agree with them or not, I thought it was a very fair-minded matter, and I hadn't gotten there until I read Quinn's article on it.
Those are interesting observations.
Yeah, and so what he's trying to do in an academic way, and this, by the way, anyone out there who's a policy wonk, this thing is like it's a wonderland. Oh, it's wonkerific. There's no question. But I think the tone, I mean, I was very concerned. I'm not going to say I wasn't. I thought the tone of the whole document and the purpose for putting this commission together was going to be completely politically driven and create almost a useless tract. I don't think this is useless. I think people are going to discuss this for a long time, kind of the way the voting commission that looked at various problems back, I think, in Jimmy Carter's time is still cited today. I mean, this has interesting proposals, and it does not favor one side or the other so greatly that you can say, oh, well, that's just a partisan document. I think these folks actually went to work. And you know, Larry Tribe's on here, and I have said that I really have not had the highest esteem for some of his recent pronouncements on the law, but I didn't see any of that sort of Twitter craziness in this document. Now, I haven't read the whole thing, but I haven't seen anything where I say, you know, that's just badly put, or that's not a proposal anyone would ever bring up, which I guess is a low bar since people bring up proposals all the time there.
Well, but let's remember too, when the membership of this august body was first announced, I was quick. I'll leave you out of it, John, but I was quick to say this is a stacked committee. I mean, this is at least 2/3 left-wing academics. It did not look like the kind of group of people that had been selected in order to produce a fair-minded piece of work. So the fact that they did, I think, is all the more impressive, or you know, suggests that I jumped the gun too quickly assuming that this group wouldn't be able to produce something more fair-minded. So it's good that I was wrong in that, and it's good that you view this as relatively fair-minded. Even if we wouldn't necessarily endorse these ideas or this way of proceeding, it's still good to have a relatively fair-minded document out there in the debate.
Right, and it's still true. I mean, I think of the 34 of the folks on there, there's like 9 people who aren't what I would call associated with the left, and that seems very small. But one of them's Adam White, who I mean, he's not going to put his name on something that's, you know, crazy. And I think that's what's happened here is that even Tribe, I guess they've pulled away from their political roles and went full wonk, which they all are, right? I mean, it's not a this is don't get on.
That's not a big departure for them.
exactly. That's exactly where I'm going. But it has the history of the court. What does judicial power come from? What's its origins and what's its nature in the United States? And I think that going back to first principles and why people listen to the court, I thought that was very good. I thought the historical analysis was very useful, particularly to lay people. And so that's how kind of it starts out. And as I said, I've not been through the whole thing. There's appendices and all other kinds of things in here. But the other thing is, I will give, you know, I did say that that I thought that this whole commission was to kick the can down the road because the president doesn't really like this stuff. He was on the Judiciary Committee for a very long time, and he's just kind of not for court packing in his heart of hearts, I think. And this was supposed to kick the can down the road, and it did. And I think the temperature has turned down enormously.
Let me ask you this, John. Do you think if this were adopted, you know, sort of lock, stock, and barrel, and at the end of the next, if the shoe's on the other foot, you're at the end of a Republican administration, the Democrats are in control of the Senate, that they would really go ahead and nominate or, you know, vote on and confirm the president's choice? Or would they say, oh, here's our chance to get back at the Scalia-Gorsuch situation?
I think they would go. I think the Senate Democrats, I think they'd do what McConnell did. I do think. But that is saying if this Professor Peck's ideas are not picked up, right?
Right.
So the thing is, if and the key thing here is always make everything come in after the next election, so nobody knows what's going to happen. That's how we got term limits for the president. You can't do it in the heat of the moment.
The veil of ignorance. Mark Chenoweth here, back with John Vecchione on Administrative Static, and we're going to jump to an important decision that came out of the United States Court of Appeals for the Sixth Circuit this past week. The case is Gun Owners of America, Inc. v. Merrick Garland in his official capacity as Attorney General, and this is one of the bump stock cases. This is not one of them that the New Civil Liberties Alliance brought, although we have been filing amicus briefs in this case, but the issue set is the same as the cases that NCLA has been pursuing in the 10th Circuit. That's the Apotian v. Garland case, which is currently pending cert at the United States Supreme Court, and the Cargill v. Garland case in the 5th Circuit Court of Appeals, which has already been argued but is pending a decision of the 3-judge panel in the 5th Circuit. So this was an en banc rehearing by the Sixth Circuit, which means that almost it should have been all the judges of the Sixth Circuit hearing this case. But in the event, one judge recused, and that left 16 judges to hear the case, and they split 8-8 in terms of the decision in the case. And as a result, and this is not something unique to the Sixth Circuit, this is just how it works throughout the federal court system. When the Court of Appeals splits evenly like that, then the lower court decision is upheld. And just pausing for a second on that, John, I you know, that's always been the case. There's nothing unusual about that happening here, but it does seem a little odd to me. You had a 3-judge panel that reversed the district court and found error there. And then you have the result of the 8-8 split at the Court of Appeals isn't that the panel opinion gets reinstituted, but rather that the district court decision gets upheld, you know, sort of not really confirmed, but just upheld by default.
That's interesting.
And, you know, I don't know. I'm sure there are other factors that go into why that's the case, but it just, it seems a little bit odd to me. We, in the 10th Circuit en banc that we had on this issue, the en banc had vacated the panel decision, which had gone against, it had been in favor of ATF, had gone against our client. And then when the en banc was ultimately, they decided that the en banc had been improvidently granted, and so they reinstituted the panel decision. But I think it would have been very odd in that case to uphold the district court decision after a panel of that court had pointed out all the flaws in the district court decision. And so that's sort of what you have here, is a lot of the flaws in the district court decision get pointed out, but then it gets upheld anyway. It's just an unusual. Well, like I say, it's not an unusual procedure in the sense that it's the way that that the rules specify it's supposed to happen, but it doesn't happen very often. And I do think that it's the kind of thing that when it happens, the U.S. Supreme Court notices. So we filed at NCLA, we filed papers with the U.S. Supreme Court in the pending case that we have in the Aposhian v. Garland case, pointing out this case, pointing out, look, you now have two circuit courts of appeals that have split almost evenly in the case of the 10th Circuit and evenly in the case of the 6th Circuit on these questions. Surely that means that this is an issue that the United States Supreme Court should look at. So for those who haven't been following the case, what are the issues in this case? Well, there are a few, but I think three of the most important issues are, one, whether or not Chevron deference applies in interpreting the statute, which means first you have to decide whether or not the statute is ambiguous, and then secondly, whether the agency's interpretation of the statute is reasonable. And then another question is whether the rule of lenity applies and when it applies, because ordinarily when you're talking about a statute that has criminal applications, that is, if people violate this law, they can go to jail, then ordinarily the rule of lenity would apply, which means that if there's an ambiguity in the statute, that would be construed in favor of the criminal defendant, not in favor of the government agency. So it's a bit odd to have a criminal statute construed in favor of the attorney general, but that's what the result is here out of the Sixth Circuit. But and I don't want to just run through the decision and sort of give you chapter and verse. You can read it for yourself if you're inclined to get all the details. It's number 19-1298, and it's available at the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals website. So, you know, if you want to dig into it, you should. It's a very interesting decision. But as I was just telling John between episodes here, or between segments here, one of the things that I have to sort of give it to the majority here in the Sixth Circuit is they don't pull any punches. This is Judge White writing for the Sixth Circuit. Judge White, although an appointee of President Bush, she was the cousin of the Democrat senator from Michigan. And you may remember this, John. I remember it well because I was working on judicial nominations in the Bush administration. There was a lot of nominees were held in order to try to force Judge White to get on the bench, and ultimately she was put on the Sixth Circuit, but she should properly be thought of as a Democrat appointee. But in any event, this case did split under roughly ideological lines. Judge White was writing for 8 judges, which includes 7 Democrat appointees and 1 Republican appointee, Richard Griffin from Michigan. And then the 8 dissenters in the case were all Republican appointees of Presidents Trump and Bush. And I didn't look, but I think there may have been at least one senior Bush appointee still on that group. But I'm not positive about that. But in any event, when I say that they didn't pull any punches, what I mean is some of the courts to look at this issue have you know tried to essentially ignore some of the issues in the case. They've just been interested in either reducing the scope of the issues or sort of pretending that the case was about something it wasn't. But in this case, the Sixth Circuit said, look, we think that the terms in the statute are ambiguous. We think that automatically is an ambiguous term. We think that words of the statute define a machine gun as any weapon which shoots, is designed to shoot, or can be readily restored to shoot automatically more than one shot without manual reloading by a single function of the trigger. And so automatically is the one term, and then single function of the trigger is the other term that have been deemed by the, I keep trying to say majority, John, but by eight of the judges as the ambiguous terms. And they walk through why they think those terms, why it's reasonable to define those terms the way that the ATF has defined them. But they also are very open about the fact that they're relying on Chevron here. And Chevron is the doctrine that defers to agencies' interpretations of ambiguous statutes. But the, you know, one of the issues here is you after the Supreme Court's decision sort of refining our deference in the Kaiser v. Wilkie case, most judges recognize that you have to apply all of the various statutory tools before you decide that something is ambiguous. And the court did that here. They sort of came to terms with that. But the one thing I think that they did that's questionable is that they've decided that the rule of lenity comes in after Chevron. So they say if there's any ambiguity left over after applying Chevron, then the rule of lenity might come into play. But the whole point of Chevron is that if there's ambiguity, you defer. So there's no point at which ambiguity would be resolved. So I found that to be the one thing that was a little bit disingenuous. They've essentially said there's no role for the rule of lenity as long as you're dealing with not a criminal statute, but a criminal regulation. And they're just very, they go through the Supreme Court precedent and they point out that there are Supreme Court cases that say that the rule of lenity applies that don't mention regulations. There are lots of cases that show the Supreme Court upholding regulations that have criminal penalties using a Chevron theory. There aren't really any good examples of a case where the Supreme Court grapples with the fact that they're dealing with a criminal statute while interpreting Chevron. The issue sort of is in the background, but not really discussed or grappled with. And that's, again, why I think either this case or preferably the Apotian case that we filed at the Supreme Court are worthy of the court's attention, because that tension between a criminal statute and Chevron has not been properly resolved by the Supreme Court. And I think the Sixth Circuit takes one side of, well, half of the Sixth Circuit takes one side of that issue and half of it takes the other side of the issue. It's an extremely important issue. If somebody can go to jail based on an administrative agency's extension of a statute that Congress passed, then you have people losing their liberty and going to jail, not because of something that Congress did, but because of something an administrative agency did. And that gets around the bicameralism and presentment. We've long had in this country a system where people can only go to jail if the Congress sets the law, the prosecutor agrees to prosecute the law, and the judge agrees that law was broken. So it's all three branches have to agree before you can have someone go to jail in this country. This process cuts the legislative branch out of that and allows executives to make law, interpret the law, prosecute the law, and then get the judiciary to go along based on a Chevron theory. And that's very dangerous. It's worthy of the Supreme Court's attention. And I think the Supreme Court will take a look at this case. I'll say just a quick word about the dissent. Judge Murphy wrote for the other eight judges. And again, he, I think, does an extremely good job of putting out all the arguments there on the other side. So I think a little bit unlike the disjointed opinions from the Tenth Circuit, although I thought there were several good dissents there, you have two clean decisions here for eight judges on one side, eight judges on the other side. They're really cleanly joined and presented, and I think will be an attractive vehicle for the Supreme Court as the opposing cases as well. We'll be back with more right after this.